Okay, thank you very much, and thanks for the opportunity to speak here today. So, as I understand it, there are two main origins for the study of Teichmüller dynamics. One is dynamics in rational polygons, and the other is the Teichmüller geometry of Teichmüller space, or moduli space. And one surprise is these end up being very closely intertwined. But in any case, today I'm going to focus on the Teichmüller geometry of Teichmüller space and moduli space. And I'll think about the Teichmüller space of genus G Riemann surfaces with N marked points. Doesn't matter if they're labeled or unlabeled. And then the moduli space is the quotient by the mapping class group. Okay, so Teichmüller space is a beautiful complex manifold. It's biholomorphic to a bounded domain in C to the 3G minus 3 plus N. And the first thing you might wonder is it like a Hermitian symmetric space? Is this a symmetric sort of manifold or not? And the answer is it's actually very asymmetric. And this was established by Royden when he showed that the group of isometries of Teichmüller space, or if you like complex geometry better, not that there's a big difference, the group of biholomorphisms of Teichmüller space is basically just the mapping class group. Okay, so it's this discrete group. There are no non-obvious symmetries at all. So how to understand this space, which although it's a very nice complex manifold, its geometry is somewhat mysterious. Well, as is often the case in math, if you have a complicated object, you choose to probe it with simpler objects. So you take some object you do understand and you consider maps from the simple objects to the complex objects. And so you probe this using Teichmüller disks. So a Teichmüller disk is a holomorphic isometry from the hyperbolic plane to Teichmüller space. And these exist in great abundance. So there is a unique such disk through any two points. So although the space is not a symmetric space, there are all of these maps from symmetric spaces into Teichmüller space. So the first comment is that Antonakoudis proved that if you'd like, you can remove holomorphic there. If you have an isometry of the Teichmüller disk into Teichmüller space, it's automatically either holomorphic or anti-holomorphic. Although that was just like a year or two ago. And he also showed that there are no higher dimensional analogs of these that are symmetric. So let me just write that. So no higher dimensional symmetric analogs. So what I mean by that is you take any higher dimensional Hermitian locally symmetric space, then it doesn't admit an isometric map to Teichmüller space. And at this point you might wonder, well, maybe there's just no natural higher dimensional subspaces of Teichmüller space which are easier to understand than Teichmüller space as a whole. And certainly this is a result in that direction. But recently we found something which isn't symmetric but is a higher dimensional analog of a Teichmüller disk. So that was joint work with Kurt McMullen and Ronan Mukamel. So there is a asymmetric analog. Well, we found one, anyways, in T13. The Teichmuller space of genus 1 Riemann surfaces with 3 marked points. And what we found is a two-dimensional, totally geodesic surface. So a totally geodesic surface. So throughout the whole talk, I'm going to work over the complex numbers. So when I say two-dimensional, I mean complex dimension 2. So if you like real dimension, just multiply all of my numbers by 2. And so this is totally geodesic, so what does that mean? So IE, it contains the Teichmuller disk through any two of its points. Okay, so to explain the terminology, I should say Teichmuller disks are often called complex geodesics. Okay, so you take a Teichmuller geodesic, which would just be a sort of a one real dimensional object, and you complexify it and you get these Teichmuller disks. And so something should be totally geodesic if it contains the geodesic through any two of its points, right? Or if you prefer, you could say for any point and any tangent direction, then it contains the Teichmuller disk, the Teichmuller geodesic through that point in that direction. Okay, so this was a bit of a surprise to us. It's the first example of something totally geodesic that's not a Teichmuller disk and doesn't arise from some sort of covering construction. And
can you repeat, what do you mean by symmetric and asymmetric? Just symmetric spaces?
Yeah, so this is not a symmetric space. Okay. So I should say you could, since this is totally geodesic, you can restrict the Teichmuller metric to it and get a nice metric on it. And then if you think of the inclusion map, with respect to that, it's trivially an isometric embedding. So this is some sort of geometric object. It's a complex manifold with a Finsler metric, and it's isometrically mapping to Teichmuller space, but it's just not a symmetric space.
Does it have any isometries?
It certainly has isometries coming from the mapping class group. I don't know if it has any isometries. Other than that, you would think probably not. And which brings to me, how do you think of this? Well, you think of this as some sort of exotic Teichmuller space. So this is, you know, in all ways similar to a Teichmuller space, but it's new and interesting and weird. And so there are many things that we know about Teichmuller spaces that we don't know about this exotic Teichmuller space. And of course, now it's natural to try to investigate those. Although that's not the topic of this talk. Any other questions so far? I'm very happy to get lots of questions throughout the whole talk.
So can you say again which other total geodesic surfaces are there?
I'll say that in a minute. So before this, there were none except for some covering from covering constructions. So a covering construction is I could take, you know, all genus 2 surfaces, and then I could look at all degree 3 unbranched covers of them, and then some component of that would be, you know, something totally geodesic. That's really not surprising, and you haven't really done much by taking a cover. But this is the first sort of strange one.
And what about the Billiard and the Wright surfaces? They are not totally geodesic?
Yeah, you don't expect any to be totally geodesic. They're totally geodesic in the moduli space of principally polarized abelian varieties with respect to the locally symmetric metrics, but that's very different than the Teichmuller metrics. Okay, so actually we didn't find it in this form. This particular two-dimensional complex surface in T13 covers a subvariety of M13. Okay, so you should actually think of it as a totally geodesic subvariety of M13, and then you could lift it to Teichmuller space. Okay, and so this is like a higher dimensional analog of a Teichmuller curve. The Teichmuller curves and Teichmuller disks being the one-dimensional totally geodesic manifolds and varieties, respectively. Okay, so now that we've found one of these weird objects, it seems natural to ask about their behavior in general and how abundant they are. If there were lots of them, we could use them to understand the geometry in the same way we use Teichmuller disks to understand the geometry. And if there aren't so many of them, well, that's interesting too, and that's indicating they're really special, and we could maybe try to classify them. Okay, so maybe before I go on, though, I should say, to answer Edward's question, we know two others of these now. So in joint work with Eskin, McMullen, Mukamel, and myself, we have two more examples, and they're an M14 and M21. And I'll comment on those later. Okay, so what do we know about Teichmuller disks that we could try to prove for the higher dimensional analogs? It seems natural. You see what you know for Teichmuller disks, and then you try to prove all of those things for the higher dimensional analogs of Teichmuller disks. Well, perhaps most importantly, so Maser and Veitch showed in the 80s that most Teichmuller disks project densely to MG. So you take this nice Teichmuller disk, which is properly embedded in a Teichmuller space, and you project it down, and it wraps around, and its closure is the whole thing. So we know that, but we also know many Teichmuller disks cover Teichmuller curves, the one-dimensional, totally geodesic subvarieties of MG. And in fact, many meaning infinitely often, right? Every time, all the square-tiled surfaces, for example, give you Teichmuller curves. So there are, you know, most cover a dense set, but also many cover varieties. Okay, so my talk today will mainly concern to what extent do these facts hold for the higher dimensional analogs. Okay. And sort of how many are there, you know? Do you have lots of higher dimensional Teichmuller disks just like you have lots of Teichmuller disks? And the answer is no, so I'm going to write it over here so I can keep it for the whole time. So in fact, the behavior is, in these senses, opposite between the one-dimensional case and the higher dimensional case. So the first theorem is every totally geodesic submanifold of dimension greater than one of Teichmuller space covers a variety, a closed variety. Okay.
I was going to ask a stupid question. I mean, can you have totally geodesic subspaces, real totally geodesic subspaces?
If you do, it's automatically complex. If you contain the Teichmuller disk between any two of your points, that forces you to be complex.
I want to think about real geodesics.
Oh, then I don't know if you would get anything else.
Okay.
Any other questions? Okay, so this is like saying every Teichmuller disk covers a Teichmuller curve, except it's every higher dimensional disk, Teichmuller disk covers a higher dimensional Teichmuller curve. And then the second theorem, is that only finitely many exist. So only finitely many totally geodesic subvarieties exist in each moduli space MGN. Okay, so those are the two main theorems that I want to talk about today. And I'm actually very happy to get to talk about these theorems. And I'm actually going to walk you through the proofs. The proofs are given in a very short preprint that I just posted to the archive. And the reason that I'm very happy to walk you through the proofs, which is something I don't often do in talks, go through entire proofs of theorems, is because really it's going to give us a tour of a number of recent developments in Teichmuller dynamics. And so, in fact, there'll be many black boxes in the proof of this, but all of these black boxes are themselves very, I think, interesting results, or at least results that I'm very happy to tell you about today. Okay.
So this is an SL to R invariant manifold that then quotients to NG. Is that right? So what? So are those not always subvarieties? Is that?
How about you ask me again in 2 minutes? Okay. So let's say I take a totally geodesic subvariety of MGN. Okay, or later some of the definitions I'll apply to just a more general subset N of NGN. Okay. But for now, say this is a totally geodesic subvariety. So the first thing we'll do is we'll set Qn. So if I have some subvariety and it contains the Teichmuller geodesic through any two of its points, one of the most natural things to think about is the set of Teichmuller geodesics it contains. Okay? Each Teichmuller geodesic is generated by a quadratic differential on a Riemann surface. So actually, I'll think about the set of Riemann surfaces with quadratic differentials that generate Teichmuller curves in this locus. And that's what Qn is going to be. So Qn is the set of xq such that the Teichmuller disk generated by Q is a subset of N. Okay, so this is Riemann surfaces with quadratic differentials that generate Teichmuller disks in the locus. And this is indeed SL2R invariant, essentially by definition, because SL2R orbits project to Teichmuller disks. Okay, and then the other thing you often will want to do is, so as I'll comment in a second, typically these are quadratic differentials that aren't the squares of abelian differentials. And whenever you have a quadratic differential that isn't the square of an abelian differential, you can take a square root of it, but you have to pass to a double cover. Okay, so there's a cover, sometimes it's called the holonomy double cover, sometimes it's called the square root. So there's a 2-to-1 branch cover on which the pullback of the quadratic differential is the square of an abelian differential. Okay, so let me just say, so these are square roots of Q of XQ in Qn. Okay, so Qn is the set of quadratic differentials, omega n is the set of abelian differentials that you get. So a quick note, maybe I'll just write this. So this is just a very general note. It doesn't, it's a good exercise. So in any subspace, complex subspace, of the quadratic differentials on any Riemann surface, and say you have a subspace of dimension greater than one, the generic, so I should say in any subspace, the generic quadratic differential is not a square. So if you take any two-dimensional subspace of quadratic differentials on any Riemann surface, and you pick one at random, then it's not going to be the square of an abelian differential. So the cotangent space to a higher dimensional totally geodesic submanifold will be a set of quadratic differentials of higher dimension, and so it won't consist of squares of abelian differentials. So there really is a difference between these things.
Does the surface Y, does its topology depend on where you are?
Yeah, so the surface Y is a 2-to-1 cover of X, but it's branched over the odd order zeros of Q. And so really this is stratified, and you could even have parts of it in different genus. But typically we're only going to look at the maximal dimensional part and just sort of very quietly ignore the smaller dimensional parts. Okay. So if N is totally geodesic of dimension D, well then I want to figure out how big is the dimension of QD, or equivalently of QN, or equivalently the size of the dimension of omega N. So I'll fill in the question mark in a second. Let's just draw a little picture. So I have my totally geodesic thing of dimension D, which I've just drawn a very crude cartoon of at the moment. And now maybe I'll look at a point in it. So then I could say, how many Teichmuller disks go through this point? Okay, well, I can pick any other point, and there's a d-dimensional space of points I could pick, and then I can draw the Teichmuller disk through those points. But of course, if I pick two points on the same line, then I get the same Teichmuller disk. So in fact, there's a d minus one dimensional space of Teichmuller disks going through that point. Okay. So that doesn't mean that there's a d minus one dimensional space of quadratic differentials, because actually, you know, when you scale a quadratic differential, you get the same Teichmuller disk. So actually, through any point, the set of quadratic differentials you get will be d-dimensional, and that'll give you this d minus one dimensional family of Teichmuller disks. So I started off with something d-dimensional, and then to each point I added a d-dimensional space of quadratic differentials. So this qn will be dimension 2d. And somehow this is important because a lot of this stuff ends up, you know, dimension counts end up featuring prominently. So are there any examples so far? So I'll also comment that omega n is, so it's GL2R invariant and closed. So in other words, it's an affine invariant submanifold. So the work of Eskin, Mirzakhani, Mohammadi says every closed GL2R invariant subset is what we now call an affine invariant submanifold, and that's just something described by linear equations in period coordinates. And Filip showed that any affine invariant submanifold is actually a variety. So in answer to your question, Chris, Qn and omega n are SL2R invariant subvarieties. So if I didn't use the word variety in totally geodesic subvariety, it wouldn't make any difference.
What's the theorem A?
Well, so theorem A is saying every higher dimensional Teichmuller disk covers something closed. It's not sort of mapping densely, so it's like, you could rephrase it by saying it covers some sort of complex orbifold. But that's sort of very unexpected, because that's the opposite of what happens for Teichmuller disks, where Teichmuller disks can project to a dense subset. Any other questions so far? OK. So now I want to think about the converse to this statement. And there is a sort of converse. So we've seen totally geodesic subvarieties give you affine invariant submanifolds, these SL2R invariant loci of abelian differentials. Now you can ask, which affine invariant submanifolds give you totally geodesic, or arise from totally geodesic varieties in this way? So there is a converse. So conversely, if omega n is an affine invariant submanifold, so I'm sort of very much abusing notation. I'm not assuming that it's arising from a totally geodesic submanifold, but I'll use the same notation here for simplicity. So maybe omega n in quotes. If I have an affine invariant submanifold of dimension 2D consisting of Riemann surfaces with an involution J, Okay, so these are going to have to be double covers of quadratic differentials. So they'll come with an involution negating the Abelian differential. And so what should I think about? So I'll think about this map from, I have a Riemann surface with an Abelian differential and an involution that negates the Abelian differential. And what am I going to do? I'm just going to map it, sorry, this is going to be a y, to y mod j. So I'll forget the Abelian differential, forget the quadratic differential, just look at that. But it's worth noting, if the quadratic differential omega squared has poles, you should mark those. Because whenever you have a quadratic differential with poles, Teichmuller theory says those should be marked points. But I'm not going to emphasize that. And the image of this map has dimension d, then image is totally geodesic. So if you have the same sort of situation with the same dimension counts, you get something totally geodesic. So you need something 2G dimensional with an involution so that when you map it, mod the involution, you get something D dimensional. So if you have the same dimension count, then automatically the image is totally geodesic. So the idea of this is very simple. So let me just give you the idea here. So here I have, I'm just going to draw a picture. Okay. So here I have, you know, whatever the image is, and I'm going to take a point in that image. Okay, and so this is some D-dimensional image. And then I'm going to consider the fiber above that point. Okay, so that fiber, so it's, maybe I'll call it d minus 1 plus 1 dimensional. So it's, one of the dimension just comes from scaling the Abelian differential. So I actually, it's, the fiber is definitely 2D dimensional, but I'd rather think of it as d minus 1 dimensional because that's how many different Riemann surfaces you get. Okay, so for each point in the fiber, you get a GL2R orbit. You just take the GL2 orbit of that. And all of those GL2R orbits project to Teichmuller disks. So here you get all of these Teichmuller disks. So these are Teichmuller disks. Okay, so here you get some sort of D-dimensional locus, and through each point you have a D-1 dimensional family of Teichmuller disks going through it. So that's the right number of Teichmuller disks to be a totally geodesic surface. Okay, so a totally geodesic subvariety is just some sort of subvariety with enough Teichmuller disks through every point, and this is enough. So that's all I'm going to say about that. Any questions? Okay, so bottom line, totally geodesic subvariety of dimension d is just an affine invariant submanifold of dimension 2d, so that when you map it like this, mod the involution, you get something of dimension d. Okay. So now I want to move on and tell you, so that was some general background, how you think about these things. So I want to tell you about these proofs, but to do that I'll need one more result. So theorem c, if n is totally geodesic, so a totally geodesic subvariety, then omega n is transverse to the isoperiodic foliation. So this foliation is also called the rel foliation or the kernel foliation or just about any name you want. It's been called that in the literature. So this foliation is the foliation along which absolute periods of omega don't change. Okay, so this is the same as saying, you might say colloquially, omega n has no rel. Okay, so what's rel or what's the isoperiodic foliation? It's easier for me to give you an example. So let me build for you an example with the slit torus construction. So I can glue together two tori along a slit. And then you could ask, what happens when I sort of make the slit longer or shorter? So I can just increase the slit or move the location of the slit. Well, you could say, well, what happens to the absolute periods? So those pink curves span homology, and their absolute periods don't change when you change the size of the slit, evidently. Okay, so that's the foliation that doesn't change the periods of the absolute homology cycles. Okay, so you should think this isoperiodic foliation is the foliation that, in a sense, changes the distances between the zeros of omega without changing anything else. Questions about what this is? So it's a good question. So as I said, Qn is stratified. And really what I want to do is I want to take the maximal dimensional stratum and then take all the square roots of that. If you take square roots of things in different strata, you might even end up in different moduli spaces. Other questions? Okay.
Yeah, are you going to explain where C comes from, or is that a black box?
Theorem C? No, I'm going to explain theorem C. But first I want to tell you a few more ways of thinking about this. So the tangent space to omega n at y omega, I'm going to denote this omega n of y omega. Okay, so this is the tangent space, so I'm just going to add on the point. And what this is naturally a subspace of H1 of y sigma, where sigma is the set of zeros of omega. So this is the relative homology group. And this has a natural forgetful map, often denoted P, to H1y. Okay? And this transversality statement, or being transverse to the isoperiodic foliation, so transverse, that statement is the same as the statement that the kernel of P doesn't intersect this omega n of y omega. So this intersection would be the part of the tangent space coming from rel deformations, and there's no rel. Okay. So another way of thinking about this, so in general, if you have some affine invariant submanifold omega n, you define its rank to be 1/2 the dimension of P of the tangent space. It doesn't matter which tangent space you use, the tangent space to any point. And this is the complex dimension. You might wonder, is this an integer? It is an integer. That's via deep theorem of Avila, Eskin, Muller. So this isn't their definition, but they proved a result that says this is an integer. And it's always an integer between 1 and the genus. Okay, so the rank of a stratum, that's just the genus, the rank of a Teichmuller curve is 1. So it's something measuring how close you are to a Teichmuller curve versus how close you are to the stratum. Just an integer. Okay. So if you have no rel, then the dimension is actually just going to be twice the rank. So this will also be if and only if dimension equals 2 times the rank. And somehow this is what we're actually going to use. Okay, so Now that I've written down theorem C, I want to say how you use theorem C and one other statement to get theorem B. Okay, so to do that, I'll need to use my joint work with Alex Eskin and Simeon Filip. Which I'll write in a few parts. So first is there are only finitely many affine invariant submanifolds in each genus in each moduli space of rank bigger than one. Okay, so this is actually all I'll use today, but maybe I'll just also comment. So these two are optional, as in you can stop paying attention while I talk about these if you'd like. I just want to tell you to complete the statement, not because it'll be used. So also for degree greater than two. So the degree is the degree of the affine field of definition. It's the degree of the number field you need to write the linear equations, locally defining the affine invariant submanifold. And we also show that infinite families with rank equals one and degree equals two, these correspond to rank two, degree one, affine invariant submanifolds. And the rank one, degree one, that's covers of tori. So that's easy. So essentially, we can tell you that there are finitely many affine invariant submanifolds, except when there aren't, which is only a special case. And even then, it's pretty special. You only get those. So you can get an infinite family, say, of quadratic Teichmuller curves, only if there's some bigger affine invariant submanifold that gives it a right to exist. Okay, so we have a fairly complete finiteness result. And this builds on all sorts of other results. In particular, I'll mention a result for Teichmuller curves recently of Haberger and Martin Muller and Matt Bainbridge. And I'll also say that Ursula Hammenstadt has some results related to this. Okay. So now theorem B is essentially a corollary of this. So proof of theorem B. Well, so omega n lives in one of finitely many strata. So that is to say, when you take this double cover, the genus can change, but it can only change so much. So you might as well assume you're in some fixed moduli space. Now, the dimension of omega, the rank of omega n is 1/2 the dimension. This is by theorem C that I haven't explained yet. And this, since this has dimension at least four, right, the n has dimension two, and omega n has double the dimension, so this is at least two. Okay, so it just follows directly from the fact that only finitely many things of rank bigger than two. So this is the proof of theorem B, assuming this result, which is really the big tool, and theorem C. Okay, so if there are no questions about that, or there is?
About the optional part.
Okay.
Just can you explain, like, the example of true logarithm for most sides is in terms of the event. So, is this related to Kurtz's result that in genus phi or phi many or something like that? I mean,
why don't we talk about this afterwards? I'll say that since this is optional for you to listen to, it's optional for me to answer your questions about it right now. But I'm happy to answer questions on anything other than the optional part. And I'm actually very happy to talk about this after. Okay. So now I want to start talking about the proof of theorem C. And that's great because it's going to take us back in Teichmüller theory to like the 50s and 60s even to some old important results about Jenkins-Strabel differentials. But first I want to mention a newer result that sort of goes in the direction, actually at the beginning it'll be totally unclear what it has to do with what I'm talking about. So Smiley Weiss showed that every horocycle invariant set of translation surfaces contains what I'm now going to call a Jenkins-Strabel differential. So, or a JK differential. JS. JK. Okay, so IE, so that's sort of an old term, so IE, often now we just say a horizontally periodic translation surface. Okay, so the proof of theorem C is actually going to hinge on the study of such horizontally periodic surfaces. So what such a surface looks like is it's just a bunch of horizontal cylinders that are somehow glued together along their boundaries. That's a Jenkins-Strabel differential. And I'm using the old term because we're going to refer to some of the old results on it. Okay, so that means in particular omega n, since it's GL2R invariant, it's in particular horocycle invariant, so it has to have one of these horizontally periodic surfaces. But I actually want it to have a lot in a certain sense. One thing I showed in my paper on cylinder deformations, and I'm not going to talk about cylinder deformations, but the key tools were this theorem of Smiley-Weiss and the theorem of Avila, Eskin, Mola over there. So actually, every affine invariant submanifold of, so I'm going to start using this notation, dimension 2a plus b, where a is the rank. So a is defined to be the rank, b is defined to be the dimension minus twice the rank. I'm just going to break it up that way. So every affine invariant submanifold has a set of Jenkins-Strabel differentials of dimension a plus b, where the circumferences are constant. It's actually a submanifold, yeah. And you can find a bigger set if you were willing to change the circumferences. Okay, but here I don't want to change the circumferences. So actually in this particular example, once you have this, the way you get to nearby surfaces is just by twisting the cylinders. Okay. So you can summarize this as saying, actually, there's a really big set of Jenkins-Strabel differentials along which the circumferences are constant in this set. Okay, they're not constant in the affine invariant submanifold, they're just constant in this set. Okay. Now, what I want to use is some results on uniqueness of Strabel differentials. So recall, on any Riemann surface, okay, so here's the setup I'm going to consider. I have some Riemann surface. I'm fixing a Riemann surface right now, no abelian differential, no quadratic differential. And I'm going to look at some disjoint set of simple closed curves that aren't isotopic. Okay, and then for these, I'm going to sort of specify what circumferences I want. Okay, so on any Riemann surface, there exists a unique Jenkins-Strabel differential with any given, so I'll just say core curves and circumferences. So that is to say, I specify the set of curves I want to be core curves, I specify the circumferences, and there's a unique quadratic differential where these are isotopic to the core curves of the cylinders, and the cylinders have the right circumferences. Okay, so actually, this was proven in a 1950s Annals paper of Jenkins. But all I'm going to use, actually, is the uniqueness. And the uniqueness is far, far easier than the existence. Okay, so I'm mentioning hard results to sort of round out the discussion, but all I'm going to use from this is a fairly easy result. So this is one of three results that goes under the statement existence and uniqueness of Jenkins-Strabel differentials. You can also ask, can you make the moduli of the cylinders be whatever you want? Instead of fixing the circumferences, you fix the moduli. So that was a 60s paper of Strabel. And then you can also say, forget about circumferences, forget about moduli, can you make the heights of the cylinders be whatever you want? And that was a 70s paper independently of Hubbard and Mazur and Renelt. Okay. But as I said, we're not using any of the hard stuff. All we're going to use is uniqueness here. And you can maybe start to see what I'm going to do, because I want to, you know, everything comes down to some dimension count. So I want to know, do I have a big set of Riemann surfaces? And if I have some uniqueness result, I might be able to show two different quadratic differentials actually live on Riemann surfaces.
Sorry, I have a quick question.
Yeah?
Don't you need your curves to be not homologous to zero here? Right? If they're going to be core curves of cylinders?
This is for a quadratic differential. Yeah, so there's a unique quadratic differential, which is Jenkins-Strabel. So I'm going to use all of this for Qn, not for omega n. Okay. So now let's do the proof of theorem C. So the image of this map Y omega j goes to Y mod j has dimension. Well, I know I have a set of Jenkins-Strabel differentials of dimension at least a plus b. And this is even after you quotient by the involution. You still have this. And I know all of those differentials give me actually different Riemann surfaces. And this is the key. It's sort of hard in general to say if two differentials live on exactly the same Riemann surfaces or not. But here they actually live on different Riemann surfaces. So on this set, the map is injective. Okay, so that means the dimension is at least a plus b. Okay. But also, by definition, the dimension is equal to 2a plus b. Okay, that's just the definition of the notation I'm using. The dimension. Sorry, you're right. So twice the dimension. So this is the dimension of the image. Okay, twice the dimension is the, so twice the dimension of n is the dimension of qn. So twice the dimension of the image is by definition 2a plus b. And these two things together imply b equals 0. Okay, so it's just like that. Okay, so that being done, I'm now going to turn to theorem A, which is really the hardest theorem of this group of theorems. So we're turning to theorem A. So suppose n tilde is contained in Tgn is totally geodesic. So this is bad notation, but it's the notation I've been using for a while, so I'm not going to stop. This isn't the universal cover of anything. The tilde just means it lives in Teichmuller space. So this is something it's just some totally geodesic submanifold, and I want to know whether or not it covers anything, okay? Suppose is totally geodesic, and the image N in MGN is not closed. So if it was closed, then QN and omega N would have to be an affine invariant submanifold by Eskin, Mirzakhani, Mohammadi. It would have to be a variety by Filip. So we'd be done. So this is a proof by contradiction, and it suffices to say, okay, if it's not closed, what happens? And so say the dimension of N is D. So that means, so not closed means the dimension of, so now I'm going to consider N bar, which is just the closure. Okay? And that, again, I can look at QN bar, all of the Teichmuller, all of the quadratic differentials that generate Teichmuller disks that stay in N bar. Okay, so this is actually, you can show this is the closure of QN. Okay, so this is some affine invariant submanifold or of quadratic differentials. And whatever the dimension of this is, it's bigger than the dimension of QN, because QN's not closed. This is an integer for, for QN bar, yeah. You're using that QN bar as some nice set.
So, but is that so polygonic in that? It could be lots of polygons.
Well, so again, this will be stratified, and really I'll look at the biggest dimensional stratum. But I'm definitely using Eskin Mirzakhani in a very crucial way to say that this is, that omega n bar is an affine invariant submanifold. Okay. So now I have N, which is sort of maybe projecting densely. You should think of the case, well, maybe N is dense. And then QN, and then N bar, which is its closure, and QN bar, which is all of the quadratic differentials that stay in N bar. So now, what I want to think about, so here are some points in N. Points in N. Okay, and they limit to a point in N bar. So I want to think about this for a second. So at each point in N, I have this bit of D-dimensional, totally geodesic submanifold through it. Okay, and actually I could do QN, and then on this I could sort of draw the direction of Q if I wanted. So then this limit point would be in QN bar, and it would be some direction at that point. Now, so these points are converging. So these are subspaces locally look like d-dimensional planes. Okay? And the set of d-dimensional subspaces is compact. So I could pass to a subsequence and get the direction of this d-dimensional manifold to converge. And when I do that, I'll find that I can take a limit of these bits of totally geodesic manifold and get a bit of totally geodesic manifold through this limit point. Okay, so what this shows is at every point xq in qn bar, there is a totally geodesic d-dimensional manifold through x containing the Teichmuller disk generated by Q. Okay, so now what I'm going to look at is I'm going to have this picture in Qn bar. Okay, then what I want to do is I want to lift it to omega n bar. So I'm going to get a point, and I'll get some sort of submanifold given by all the square roots of all the quadratic differentials of all quadratic differentials that generate Teichmüller disks in this d-dimensional bit of totally geodesic submanifold. Okay, and that'll get me some locally GL2R invariant manifold. Okay. Well, I'm just going to lift a bit of this manifold to here, and so it just has sort of a local GL2R action. So it's GL2R invariant, but only for this local action. So I can only act, you know, here's a point. If I do a bit of GL2R, I end up here. I mean, you could actually do this in Teichmüller space and then just say GL2R invariant. It doesn't matter. Okay. So Kontsevich says that this must be linear. So a folklore result of Kontsevich proves that if you have any locally GL2R invariant manifold, then it's actually linear. So I drew this wrong. This is something linear, and it actually contains omega, the square root of Q. So this is not a particularly hard result, not that it's obvious, because it's just a local statement. There's not much you can use. Okay. So now let R prime of Y omega equal the set of real linear D dimensional subspaces of omega n bar of y omega obtained as above. Okay, so let me explain that. So I showed there's at least one bit of totally geodesic submanifold through each point. There might in fact be many, because the submanifold n might run around and cross itself and go crazy. For each one, I lift it and I get this subspace, which you can show actually lives in the tangent space. Okay, and I'm just going to look at the set of all of those things. Okay, so this guy is closed and GL2R invariant. Okay, so claim R prime is not everything.
Is not everything.
So it's not all d-dimensional planes containing omega arise. Okay, so proof. So again, we're going to say dimension of omega n bar is 2a plus b, where a is the rank. And this is greater than 2d. Okay. So now what I'm going to do so maybe I won't write this actually, but I'll just say roughly what you do. You take the surface you got over here, and you take a subspace containing all of these directions of Jenkins-Drabel directions. And you can show using the same uniqueness result of Jenkins-Drabel differentials that that maps to a subspace of MGN that's too high dimensional. So maybe I'll erase this and just say use Jenkins-Drabel differentials as above. Okay, so now I only have a minute left, but I can say the idea now. So my work with Alex Eskin and Simeon Filip restricts the GL2R invariant subvarieties of the set of planes, D planes, in the tangent space. Okay, so suppose you have this set of planes, and suppose you could show this was a variety. Okay, so what Alex and Simi and I did is we computed what's called the algebraic hull of the Kontsevich-Zorich cocycle. And that's enough to show you that there are no unexpected equivariant subvarieties like this. So you're left with one problem, which is this a subvariety? And I have no reason to believe that this is a subvariety. But you can replace this with a different definition of something which is a priori larger and is a subvariety. And you can work with that larger thing instead. And then you can use my work with Alex and Simeon to show that actually the analog of this object is really, really large. Right? And it's so large, it has to contain a subspace with too many Jenkins-Strabel differentials. And from that, you get a contradiction. OK, so I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
Please ask questions in the microphone. Any questions?
What did you use in this proof that you're not, that you're larger than one-dimensional?
So that comes up right here. So if I had had time, I would have done this for you in detail. But the actual details of showing R primes and everything involve some very simple numerical inequalities, like the one we did before. And in one of those very simple numerical inequalities, you need D is greater than 1. And that's the only place it's used.
Could you just say a word about the degree of the two examples, the new ones, in your work with Alex Kurt and Ronan?
The other two are degree 2.